business. The next meeting will be December 3rd, and will feature the annual Christmas with the Masons. Every year I stand up here and say it's my favorite meeting of the year, and this year is no exception. The meeting starts at 6:30. The Mason house will be decorated for Christmas. There will be fires in the fireplaces and enough candles so we can see where we're walking. There will be hot cider and goodies in the winter kitchen. Please come at 6:30. We hope to have the bell ringer stand. It's one of the best meetings of the year. The artifact of the month is on the wall behind me, back here. It is the charter for the Lucky Clover 4-H Club on East Bethel from an anonymous donor. There are all kinds of seals in gold around the charter for each year, and it looks as though the charter, which is not dated, was sometime in the late 20s. There is a seal for 1927, I believe. Randy, you have some announcements on anything?
Yeah, just a few things. Jory Arnell just donated a couple of Victorian pillows to the Historical Society, and I asked her about the histories of Upton that her father did, and she mentioned that they've been sold, they have been selling them at the store in Upton, and of course we have some here, and she said they're all sold out in Upton, and we have 8 left. So there are only 8 copies of Haywood's History of Upton left, so that's my promotion on that. If anyone wants to give someone a copy for Christmas, we have them. At the back of the room in the 2 display cases, we have 2 autograph quilts that the Society owns. One of them was made by the Methodist Church women in Mason on the right, and next year we hope to do a program on Mason. Mason will be 150 years old, as will Hanover. And the other one has lots of names from West Bethel and the western part of the town, and since we're finally doing a program tonight that doesn't cover East Bethel, the eastern part of the town, I thought it would be interesting to throw a few West Bethel things in. One of our members has been working on a book that's just been published called The Waterford Water Cure, which is about a water cure spa that existed at the lake house at Waterford Flat for many, many years. And one of the things that the author used with the help of one of our members, Sylvia Civilist of Waterford, is our microfilm newspaper collection, and I'll leave this down front and you can take a look at that later. The Maine Olmsted Alliance has sent a representative to Bethel to survey some of the landscape architecture and monuments here. They've also done a lot of work on area towns in Andover. They're covering the Common here at Bethel, the Bethel Hill Common up front, the Civil War Monument in Kimball Park, and they're quite concerned with what might be built behind the Civil War Monument here in Bethel, and I think we're rather anxious to see if something's going to happen there. In Freiburg, Bradley Memorial Park, Norway, Witherell Park on Main Street, Paris Hill, both commons there. At Rumford Center, they're surveying the Civil War Monument, and if any of you drive on Route 2 to Rumford Center, you may note that it's recently been painted yellow. The lettering on the stone monument has been painted yellow, and hopefully we'll be able to do something to change that. And in South Paris, Moore Park is being surveyed. Next year, it's a little editorial from my hometown, the Midlandville Common will be surveyed at Woodland Cemetery. And there are some other things here too, and I'll leave this down front for you to look at later on.
Thank you, Randy. And Tom,
the lights. Okay, just for all set then.
William B. Lapp of 1891 history of Bethel states, in the west part of the town, Grover Hill, named for the early settlers there, has always been noted for its fine agriculture and also for its fruit culture. This slide of the Grover Hill area, taken from a wall map of Oxford County, published in 1858, presents a clear picture of the large number of prosperous farms that once lined both sides of present-day Grover Hill Road. Beginning at Bethel Hill Village, in the upper right-hand corner of the map, the Grover Hill Road runs to the left in a westerly direction until it intersects with a now discontinued section of the road that once led north to the steam mill section of town and the so-called Grover Hill Cemetery. The present Grover Hill Road then turns to the south, where it skirts the eastern side of Sparrow Hawk Mountain, eventually crosses over the Portland Pipeline, and again turns west, where it soon comes to the West Bethel Flat Road at the so-called Four Corners. Because a section of the old Grover Hill Road, off Route 2, at Steam Mill, is now more closely identified with that part of Bethel, it will not be included in tonight's presentation. However, a future program highlighting that historic area is already in the planning stage. Another important 19th century map of the Grover Hill area was produced in 1880 as part of an atlas of Oxford County. Again, the numerous farms and house sites are shown, as are two schoolhouses that functioned throughout the second half of the 19th century. In addition to several maps, including the current Bethel tax maps, some of the sources for this talk have included the Lapham History, the Bethel Centennial Booklet, local newspaper columns, a 1970 paper by Gwendolyn Stearns entitled Grover Hill Memories, and interviews with several people with family connections to the Grover Hill area. Many hours were also spent at the Oxford County Registry of Deeds in an attempt to trace properties as far back as possible. Because of the limited time available tonight and the large number of sites to be covered, this program will include only a brief history of each location. Hopefully, the printed version of this talk in the Society's newsletter will allow a fuller account. Commonly known as Six Hills, the Grover Hill area was named for the family of early settler John Grover, who came to Bethel before the 1781 Indian raid and was a man sent to Freiburg for assistance after that now famous event. Early references indicate that before 1800, much of the land adjoining the Grover Hill Road was owned by Grovers, including a few who resided closer to what is now West Bethel Village. Compared to other parts of Bethel, especially East Bethel and Bethel Hill, Grover Hill has had much less attention paid to it by local historians. Perhaps when a new history of the town is published for our bicentennial of incorporation in 1996, more can be said about this part of the community.
Barry, can I interrupt this for
yes.
a second? Are you all clear on where Grover Hill is on the map? The lower part, Stanley, do you want me to? Yeah, right there.
Okay.
Yeah, right down to there, and then up. But it stops right there.
Right.
So we're not doing the steam mill part.
You're going down this way?
Right, that's Mill Hill right there. You go across and then turn left and come down. Right, and that's Grover Hill. Down to the Munt Farm right there, and then you go out to West Bethel right there.
Those four.
Four corners, right. Flat.
Standing near the eastern end of Grover Hill Road, where it joins Route 5 in Mill Hill, is the present home of Keith Davis. time of her death on October 30th, 1989, Mrs. Merrill was living with her daughter, Phyllis Blake. The house was torn down and burned in the spring of 1990. Behind the old house, on the side of the present Blake house, was a small camp shown in this photo. It was also taken down at the time the trailer was moved onto the property. Further up the hill, on the right-hand side of the road, is the gate Silas Wheeler property on the adjacent road eventually was added to a parcel on the Payne Road, something about its history may be of interest. The earliest reference to this site in deeds dates from 1849, when John Hibbert had his homestead farm here. In that same year, Hibbert sold the Edwin C. Coffin of Bethel, who in turn sold the Silas G. Wheeler in 1853. Wheeler remained here only until 1860, at which time his land and buildings became the property of Alvin Grover, whose own farmstead is shown just off the Payne Road on this map of 1880. The son of Eli Grover and grandson of the early Bethel settler, Deacon James Grover, Alvin Grover lived in Newry in Albany before purchasing this hillside farm south of the Grover Hill Road. At his death in 1882, his son Albert Grover took over the farm. The Oxford County Advertiser, November 8, 1895, carried an interesting article about this cottage, about this property. There was a pleasant family gathering at the residence of Albert D. Grover Saturday, November 2nd, when the children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, with a few other relatives, met to commemorate the 77th birthday of Mrs. Olive Wheeler Grover, Albert's mother. Her children were all present on this occasion, save one son, Eugene, who resides in the Far West, and an adopted daughter, Mrs. Emma Barker, of Portland. Mrs. Grover was the recipient of a nice spring rocker, a token of love and esteem from her children, grandchildren, and great-granddaughter. Her brother, E.G. Wheeler, Esquire, being unable to attend, sent a letter, a portion of which is as follows. Anticipating the makeup of your company, a 1903, Rachel and Jenny Mayberry sold this property to their sister, Val Hutchinson, with the stipulation that they be allowed to realize $200 from the sale of timber on one quarter of the land to pay for an erect monument to their parents' memory. That gravestone was eventually purchased and placed in Woodland Cemetery, where it remains today. In 1945, Irwin and Alton C. Hutchinson sold the property to Ernest Blake, who in 1946 sold it to Earl and Krauss. At the south end of the Payne Road are the ruins of the Payne House itself, which was probably erected soon after the property was purchased by Reuben L. Payne late in 1845. According to Glenn Stern, Reuben Payne somewhat resembled a biblical prophet with long beard and bristling eyebrows in later life. It was also said that he had many cats, all of which had names and were allowed to eat from his plate at the table. After the Payne, many other people resided here. These have included Rachel Mayberry, John B. Abbott, Albert F. Cotton, and Edward Hall. At the time the house and land was sold to P.H. Chadman in 1956, this place was known as the Burton Abbott Farm.
Mr. Decker has a problem. We'll eventually get there.
Returning to the Grover Hill Road and proceeding west, one soon arrives at the site of the farmer David M. Grover House, indicated here in 1880 near the road that once went north to steam mill. Deeds reveal that a house existed here as early as 1848 when Silas Grover conveyed large barn.
Thank you.
Which Libby tells us fell into disrepair and was finally taken down. This photograph was taken at the time of a family reunion at the Lyon House. The children are Catherine Lyon Bush on the left and Eleanor Lyon Bean on the right. Some of the adults in the photo are Barbara Carter Lyon, second from the left, Mildred Hepworth Lyon, fourth, Edward Lyon, sixth, Charles Lyon, seventh, and Fred Hepworth, eighth. Another photo shows, from left to right, Fred Hepworth, Harry Lyon, Alfred Peasley, Charles Lyon, and George Hepworth. Ed Lyon, in the previous photo, will be remembered by many as a prominent Bethel jeweler whose business was, for many years, at the present Bethel Town Office site in the Coal Block. Around 1923, the second house also burned. Soon afterwards, Herb Swan built this house for the reported sum of $1,500. The Harry Lyon family was residing in the present Pat Bennett House on Paradise when this house was destroyed by a chimney fire in 1928 or 1929. Thereafter, the site remained vacant until the present house was begun by Clayton Bain and Harry Lyon in 1948. In 1965, Harry Lyon sold the property to Clayton and Libby Bain. I believe there's another picture up here you can look at later of the Lyon family. Directly across the road and nearly hidden by trees is the seasonal home of Joseph Cosma of Scarborough, Maine. This 5.6 acres on which this log and frame house is situated was deeded to Douglas and Suzanne Bain from Clayton and Libby Bain in 1974. The house had been started a year earlier. Having moved to near Pittsfield, Maine, Doug and Sue Bain sold to the present owner in 1987. One of two schools on the Grover Hill Road was formerly located on the west side of the road, 100 yards south of the Bain and Cosma houses. Though no photo of the school has been uncovered yet, it probably closely resembles this example, which still stands in altered form at North Murray. Research into the origin and history of this Grover Hill schoolhouse was made all the more difficult because three different maps of Bethel show it in three different locations. So all were situated in the same immediate area. Since the recollections of old Grover Hill residents places the building on the right-hand side of the road below Libby Bain's, we will leave the matter there for the present time. Bethel's district school records, recently turned over to the society, provide some interesting clues to the story of this Grover Hill schoolhouse, which was listed as district number 24. A school existed in this vicinity in the 1820s, and by 1835 had 41 scholars. In the earliest entries in the records, the school district was identified with the name of a local farmer, quite often in the same man who boarded the teacher and provided wood for the schoolhouse. For example, in 1837, this was known as the Otis Grover District. The first reference labeling this the Grover Hill School was made in 1839. Payment for teachers usually amounted to only a few dollars per term, spring, summer, fall, and winter, and the names of those teaching, both men and women, changed frequently. After the Civil War, notations for repairs of the schoolhouse appear more frequently, though no references exist to explain when and if the schoolhouse was actually moved, as some early maps suggest. While it is unclear when the school disappeared, Gwen Stearns recalled the many lyceums, debates, hymn sings, and spelling matches that took place here. The official records, which run from the 1820s to the late 1880s, indicate that the largest number of students here was 67 in 1850-51 and 1851-52, while the smallest number was 14 in 1870. appears in the center, right on the slide. Only a cellar hole remains on what is now a 120-acre tract owned by Boise Cascade. This place was a side hill, but a slightly farm, according to Gwen Stern. At the time of the 1850 federal census, Samuel and Mary Pendleton resided here. In 1863, deed records records the property purchased by John B. Peasley, who remained here until 1900. The place was later owned by Ebenezer Kilburn, Edwin and Asa Smith, and Dr. Isaac H. White, who bought it in 1931. His daughter, Vivian White Martinson, sold it to Alma Trask in 1949, and his heirs sold it to the Oxford Paper Company, now Boise, in 1966. The former home of Gwen Stern, situated on a hillside above the Grover Hill Road, is now owned by Stephen and Louise Lovejoy of Wallfield, New York. This well-preserved 19th century house was once at the center of an active farm, which included a large barn and outbuilding, apple orchards, a small brick yard, and extensive acreage for growing hops. A teacher at the Brick Grammar School, Gwen Stern, spoke fondly of her childhood on Grover Hill in a program given to the society many years ago. She and her brother Carl were well known to the society's older members before their deaths in 1983 and 1977, respectively. This photo of Gwen was provided by Billy Bain. The Stern place traces its origins as far back as the 1840s, when certain deeds listed it as the homestead farm of Nathan Eames. The property was owned briefly in the early 1860s by Daniel B. Grover, who sold it to Thomas Stearns of Newry, Gwen Stearns' grandfather, in March of 1863. It remained in the Stearns family until 1956, at which time it was acquired by Edwin C. Lovejoy of Poland, Maine, whose family still own it. The property now consists of 40 acres on both sides of the road. And I believe Elizabeth brought in a photo, it's on the wall over there, that Gwen Stearns painted from her front window in her house, looking across the road. The home of Herbert Lyon, Libby Bain's brother, was built in 1980 along the Grover Hill Road. South of the house is a 10-acre orchard in which Herbert carries on the long-standing tradition of apple growing in this part of Bethel. The remaining 11 acres on this side of the road and some 200 acres on the west side were once part of the farm of Tilton Bennett. Standing nearly across the road from the Lyon House, the former Tilton Bennett residence is today owned by Andrew Featherin of Newington, New Hampshire. Though extensively remodeled, this house of circa 1850 has had an interesting history. This property, which originally included Herbert Lyon's present holdings, first appears in a deed of 1839 when Clement Seavey sold it to William Stevens of Waterford. Stevens sold to Tilton Bennett and his wife, Abiah Bean, for $20. In 1850, and it was they who probably erected the house shown here, the property passed to Tilton Bennett's son, Freeland Bennett, in 1878, and eventually to Marion Tyler, Freeland's daughter, in 1906. The Tylers resided here for many years, and the farm later passed to Ernest and Mary Prager in 1950. They sold the house and surrounding acreage to Herbert and Arlene Lyon in 1953, and they in turn sold to the Trefethen family in 1962. Only a little over 1 acre remains with the house from the original Bennett farm. Overlooking an open field from atop a steep hillside, this modern home stands. photograph was identified several years ago by the late Albert Skilling as being the last house in Bethel on the now abandoned road which leads from the former Mount House east into Albany. Known for many years as the Prescott Bennett Farm, this connected farmstead stood directly in the path of the Portland Pipeline, though the exact date of its disappearance is unknown at this time. Deeds from the present time back into the 1830s have been uncovered. Apparently, the land was owned by Moses Patty from 1837 to 1860, even though Josiah Heath, Emmeline Heath's grandfather, is shown here on the 1858 map. In any case, Heath bought from Patty in 1860, but sold out to his cousin, E. Prescott Bennett of Gilligan, in 1866. Thereafter, the farm remained in the hands of the Bennett family until 1903, when George H. Bennett sold it to Arthur F. Morrill of Mason. Later owners included George Morrill, Fritz Tyler, Myron Morrill, Donald Morrill, Harold Rolfe, and O'Neill Mills, the present owner. On July 8, 1941, Myron and Viola Morrill granted an easement to the Portland Pipeline Company. A portion of the barn foundation remains at the north edge of the pipeline right of way. Returning to the Grover Hill Road, we soon arrive at a sharp right-hand turn, which years ago was where the road to Albany branched off to the left. Above the turn is this house built around 1959 on the site of a much earlier farmstead destroyed by fire the previous year. Here we see a photo of the older property, which was home to three generations of Heaths in the 19th century. The house is better known today as the former home of the Munt family, who resided here for over 50 years in this century. A deed recorded in 1839 gives the sale of this property shown here in a photo taken between 1912 and 1918 from Uriah Holt of Albany to Daniel G. Holt of Bethel. Daniel Holt may have erected part of the building shown here, which was sold to Tilton B. Heath in 1854. The farm eventually passed to Tilton's son, Jonathan R. Heath, and later to Jonathan's brother, Isaac Cutting Heath. During the 1880s and 1890s, the Norway Advertiser ran a column entitled Heath's Corner, which contained news about the family who resided on this end of the Grover Hill Road. In 1893, the property was acquired by Edwin C. Rowe and sold a few years later to Fred A. Munt, who retained it until his son-in-law, Clayton Mills, took over ownership in 1952. This photo from the collections of Martha Fifield Wilkins shows a Munt family gathering on the lawn near the house, probably around 1930. Note the Grover Hill Road and the open fields in the background. From the Society's collections comes this pair of photos, part of a series that shows Bertha Munt, Fred's wife, demonstrating the process of turning wool into handmade mittens. Fred and Bertha had seven children: Bertha, Alice, James, Malcolm, George, Ernest, and Margaret. George Munt was killed in World War I, and the local American Legion post carried his name. Alice Munt was until her recent death, a leading authority on Oriental art and had worked for many years in the Worcester Art Museum. And Ernest Munt was long a society member until his death a short while ago. Of the fire here in 1958, the Bethel Citizen stated, "The summer home of Mrs. Charlotte Whalen of Somerville, Mass. was nearly destroyed by fire last Friday evening. Household furnishings on the ground floor were saved, but all on the second floor, including many treasured books and antiques, were lost. The barn connecting the shed and most of the house were destroyed. The on the opposite side of the